The sun, the prime ingredient of a holiday on Rhodes, was ordained by the gods.
The legend goes something like this. Zeus, the chairman of the board of gods, decided to divide the world and dish out the various lands among his fellow directors. Everyone got a share except the sun god Apollo, who happened to be on a business trip at the time. So Zeus was very apologetic and offered to start the whole process all over again. But Apollo said that wouldn't be necessary because he'd just seen emerging from the Aegean Sea a brand new island rising from the depths like a dripping mighty Wurlitzer. He didn't put it quite like that exactly, but whatever he did say did the trick because Zeus granted him the island, which turned out, as you may have guessed, to be Rhodes. That's the legend, and Rhodes has never looked back.
And Apollo must be smiling still, because the sun shines here 330 days a year, and the summer temperatures are seldom out of the 80s. So this is a fairly typical holiday activity, slightly more strenuous than most, because here you occasionally have to watch the scenery go by. The Triton leaves Rhodes Harbour every morning at 9 o'clock to cruise up the east coast. She's an old ferry boat which used to run to Turkey, or as it's referred to now, Asia Minor. At midday, Triton anchors in a rocky bay. The passengers land for lunch to be greeted on the quayside by Mikhaili, who's been greeting tourists on this quayside for 17 years.
Kalimera.
How are you?
Hey.
Good morning. Hello.
You found a tasky boat?
Hello, man.
Back.
Lunch follows in a shaded taverna on the beach. Grilled fish and salad consumed to the strains, I think is the word, of Mikhaili's violin. Mikhaili is 73 this year. He used to be a farmer, but he says he likes his new job better. It's his boast that he's never had a music lesson in his life. After lunch, it's back to the boat and on to one more beach. Yet for all its sunshine, there's a good deal more to Rhodes than its sea. The waterfront of Rhodes town, jingling with expensive yachts, provides an instant index to the hodgepodge of history which has been made here. The statues of the deer stand where the Colossus of Rhodes is supposed to have straddled the harbour entrance, one of the wonders of the ancient world. Beside the three landmark windmills, the lighthouse sits on top of a Venetian fort. Rhodes was attacked, besieged and conquered for centuries, but it's within the massive ramparts of the old town that the island's past survives most vividly. Rhodes was the headquarters of the Knights of St. John. They bought the island in 1306 and then set about fortifying the city. At the centre was the Palace of the Great Master, which today is perhaps the most complete medieval castle in existence. The buildings may be medieval, but the bazaar is strictly a 20th century affair. There are 3,000 tourist shops in Rhodes, most of them in the old city. In the Caffeineum, the last of the traditional coffee shops, old men gather to pass their days playing tavli, a version of backgammon. And the baker still fishes his loaves from a wood-burning oven. Such places still keep a toehold amid the deluge of bars, restaurants and gift shops which sell everything from jewellery to drink, fashion to furs. But whoever would think of buying mink in an island with a subtropical climate?
There is, of course, a reason for such oddities. When Rhodes was liberated in 1945, it brought to an end 647 years of continuous occupation. In a mood of rash magnanimity, the Greek government granted the island duty-free concessions on certain items, and a number of them were then taken away again almost as quickly. The ones that weren't have now been paid to by Greece joining the common market. But some effects of the old dispensation remain, which is why this is still about the cheapest place in the world to buy a decent umbrella.
What purport to be Paris Couturier's models sell for as little as £4. At one time, a Greek buying umbrellas here would have had to declare them to customs before he returned to the mainland. There was even an umbrella duty-free allowance, 7 per person. But the island's most spectacular sight is Lindos. High above a cobalt sea, on a 370-foot cliff, stand the columns of a temple erected to the goddess Athena 2,000 years ago. St. Paul would have looked on these stones when he landed in the bay below. From the 9th century BC, almost to the coming of Christianity, this was one of the most important and powerful cities in Greece. Below is the village of Lindos, curled across the hill like a dogcot. The complete village has been designated an archaeological site, which places it under strict controls. There's also no traffic except for the fleet of donkeys. They load up with day trippers at the bottom of the village and saunter off up to the Acropolis.
The special laws in Lindos extend even to the donkeys. They have to keep to a speed limit, or so I'm told. But with the temperature around 100 and a long climb ahead, who's arguing? Come on, boy, you can make it. Rhodes isn't as Greek as most of the Greek islands, but then with the history it's had, you'd hardly expect it to be. It's more cosmopolitan, and its tourism is a big industry. But beneath it all is that infectious friendliness that is truly Greek. And above it all, unfailingly, is Apollo's son.